Skiza! Kondara!
Welcome to the 18th century, as it was here in Middle Tennessee. It is our sincere desire to increase your awareness and appreciation for those who came before us more than 200 years ago. There are two different structures at this location that will give you a powerful insight into the life and survival of the Tennessee frontier inhabitants that began here during the era of the American Revolution. What you are about to experience is one of the most historically accurate reconstructed frontier forts in the United States, along with one of the few remaining original brick homes in this part of the country. These sites annually provide a rugged backdrop for living history events, historic interpretation, and film productions. Our first stop is Mansker Station, a small and crude frontier fort named for Kasper Mansker, a prominent long hunter and explorer of German descent, who along with his wife Elizabeth led several families into this region to settle in the fall of 1779. Born on a ship that was bound for America, the life of Kasper Mansker would be filled with adventure and constant danger. Restless and eager to explore new territory, Mansker and several friends journeyed from home on long hunts for deer, bear, elk, and buffalo hides, sometimes gone for a year at a time. In 1772, during one of his many hunting trips from Virginia, Mansker and a party of long hunters visited the Middle Cumberland country. Returning several times over the next 7 years, Mansker decided to stay. A resourceful woodsman, he chose this once pristine location because of the ample water supply and the salt licks that attracted deer, buffalo, and other wildlife. Originally located 1/2 mile from here, this is a smaller scaled version of Mansker's first fort. The rough construction is typical of the handful of small community defenses in Kentucky and Tennessee during this period of history. Bringing only a handful of tools and other items that were carried or packed on horses, it was ingenuity and backbreaking labor that built this little fort. Hastily thrown together for the impending and sporadic Indian attacks, Mansker Station features a pair of prominent blockhouses, each 2 stories high, walls of sharply pointed tree trunks pierced with loopholes for rifle fire, connected by a series of small cabins, all built with round logs. The roofs slant inward, leaving guards less vulnerable as they defend the fort from elevated positions. A firing ledge along the wall allows the defender to fire his flintlock through the loophole, then step back from harm's way. Self-contained for small sieges, the fort features its own water supply from a spring, food and gunpowder storage, and a blacksmith shop. The use of glass for windows was non-existent, so all window openings were secured with wooden shutters. Despite the precautionary details, Mansker's first fort would not stand very long. After 16 months, the continuous attacks on the small enclosure finally forced the surviving inhabitants to evacuate to safer areas. Within a short time, the Indians burned Mansker Station to the ground. Undaunted, the resilient Mansker and his companions returned 3 years later and built a larger second fort where he lived for the remainder of his life. Considered to be the first official innkeeper on the Cumberland frontier, Mansker and his fort became the temporary refuge for many settlers coming into the area. Some of these frequent visitors were very well known. Daniel Boone, Isaac Shelby, Captain James Robertson, Captain William Bowen, Isaac Bledsoe, Hugh McGarry, General Daniel Smith, and a future president who rented a room from Mansker until he was married, Andrew Jackson. Years later, Mansker would take up arms with the Tennessee Volunteers and join his old friend Jackson and his ragtag army at the famous Battle of New Orleans. Kasper Mansker died in 1821 at the ripe old age of 70, survived only by his wife, Elizabeth, a woman with whom he rarely shared any time. They had no children. 4 years after her husband's death, the widow Mansker was married to Isaac Walton, a neighbor and himself a widower. Elizabeth lived another 16 years. Like many others, the life story of Kasper Mansker embodies the spirit of the true American frontiersman, a rugged individualist who believed in himself and the wilderness he so loved. A contemporary remembered Kasper Mansker in this way. Though without education, he was a man of fine sense. He was a great woodsman and a mighty hunter, one of the best marksmen I ever saw shoulder a rifle. And no man among us understood better than he did how to fight the Indians. Here, in stark contrast to Mansker Station, is the surviving evidence of those who aspired for more comfortable dwellings than the primitive log structures that were first built out of desperation and protection. Listed in the National Register of Historic Places, the Bowen Plantation House is thought to be one of the oldest remaining brick residences in Middle Tennessee and the first brick building in the region. It was built in 1787 by Captain William Bowen, a veteran of the Revolutionary War and a man of considerable wealth. Living here with his wife, Mary, and their 9 children, this beautiful home was considered one of the finest and most elegant structures of its time and place. Bricks were made on the premises and laid in the Flemish bond pattern, an interlocking method that is not only strong, but attractive as well. With its double front doors, twin chimneys, 2 fireplaces and staircase, it was a mansion compared to the rugged cabins inside the fort. The original structure had only 4 rooms, 2 downstairs and 2 above. There was also a cellar kitchen with 2 rooms. The chimneys at each end of the house accommodated fireplaces for all 4 main rooms and 1 for the kitchen. 1 chimney was built outside the wall, the other inside. The front of the house, which faces Mansker's Creek, has 2 entrances into each downstairs room, and each room has a front and back window. The window glass was brought from Kentucky by pack horses. No easy task in those days. Life on the Tennessee frontier was always a challenge. Farming and maintaining over 4,000 acres of land kept Bowen and his family busy. With scattered Indian raids continuing, the Bowens, like everyone else, flocked to Mansker's second fort for protection. On one rare occasion, with all of their servants, neighbors, horses, and cattle. William Bowen died in 1804 at the age of 62. His wife Mary died in 1827 at the age of 67. They are buried in the family cemetery behind the house. Their daughter Catherine married David Campbell of Virginia. Captain Bowen's grandson, William Bowen Campbell, grew up to be the governor of Tennessee. During your visit here today, take in the sights, the sounds, and smells of 18th century life. Think about all the people who passed this way. People who were strong-willed and determined to make a new and better life for themselves, their children, and future generations. This is not just another story about some strangers of long ago. It is a story about all of us.